let's ask the Lord to do something new in our lives. We represent thousands of church members and millions of unconverted souls and millions of nations. We have come with the hope and expectation of multitudes. And God has raised us up in our generation for something unique and special. Can we do it without Him, without His healing us, empowering us? Let us cry unto the Lord that we are ready as His vessel to be taught and to be empowered, so that we are released back into the field of ministry. Great things will be done. In Jesus' name we pray. Eternal Father, we are grateful to you for this privilege, this precious program. What a platform where you have been exposing us to deep and rich and wonderful revelation, taking away our weakness and giving us your strength, forging us, polishing us, pruning us, and preparing us for a great harvest. Father, we are grateful. We ask that, Lord, you will complete and perfect your work in us, upon us, before we leave here, so that your work can be done through us by the time we leave here. Thank you because you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Again, this evening we come for our series of studies on Bible character. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. A study of Bible character is profitable for all saints and servants of the Most High God, for it is part and parcel of all scriptures. Thereby, that is, by the study of Bible characters, we intimately interact with these characters and we gain instructive insights into their lives. We are able to do a number of things. One, we are able to acquaint ourselves with their stories through in-depth analysis. Two, we are able to acknowledge their successes and also recognize their weaknesses. And then three, we are able to acquire their strength as we pray and consecrate to God, and thereby be facilitated, enhanced, helped, assisted to succeed in the race, in our life, and in our ministry. Character studies achieve the following in our life. One, we are inspired by their examples, their worthy, winsome, and wise examples. Two, we are instructed by their exhortations. Some of the characters we've been looking at, we see some exhortations, injunctions, instructions, challenges, and they spend that in the scriptures and inspiration for our consideration, for our careful thought, and then for our compliance and conformity to help us to be who God wants us to be. Three, we are invited to greater heights by their own experiences. As we look at these men, with the kind of life they lead, with the kind of faith they have, with the closeness to God they enjoy, with the purity of heart and life they manifested, it's like a come up higher call to us, telling us that where we are is not the ultimate. We need to go up there. We need to climb up higher. We need to ascend to greater heights as we see these Bible characters. For we are trending, invigorated by their endurance. As we see what they went through, all that they endured, it invigorates us, strengthens us to face any challenge we may be having today. Today, we are looking at this unique character, Stephen. Our topic is Stephen, sanctified and spiritual. Stephen, sanctified and spiritual. We come to a most profound study of one of the most celebrated characters of the New Testament. He was among the best, the brightest, the most brilliant and beautiful. His life was righteous and manifestly holy. His life was radiant, and his labors were richly rewarding and resourceful. As we examine this character, we find that the story of his life spans two chapters of the book of Acts of the Apostles, chapters 6 and 7. And those two chapters, as we read through, naturally divide into two. One, the background. Two, the biography. One, the background to his emergence. How it came out. I was thrown up on the platform of ministry and leadership. And he has come into the focus of the church for all ages. How he came up, the background to that. And then two, his own biography. Now the background, in Acts chapter 6. I read from verse 1. Acts of the Apostles chapter 6, from verse 1. And in those days, when the number of the disciples was multiplied, there arose a murmur of the Grecians against the Hebrews, because their widows were neglected in the daily ministration. Then the 12 called the multitude of the disciples unto them and said, it is not reason that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. Wherefore, brethren, look ye out among you 7 men of honest report, full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business. But we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. And from verse 5, you see the biography. And the same pleased the whole multitude, and the church teeming, a man full of faith and of the Holy Ghost. Now, before I go into the story of Stephen, from this background, we learn a number of lessons. Number one, prompt resolution of conflict. There was a conflict at hand, and it threatened the unity, the sanctity, the purity of the early church. The leader did not overlook it or trivialize it. They addressed it promptly, so as to keep the unity, the sanctity, and the purity of the church. What a lesson to all leaders today, that the least or the smallest or the minutest of problems in the church will not be ignored or delayed in being considered and resolved. Prompt resolution of conflict. Number two, we see people's recommendation and consultation. They told them, they interacted with them. Intimately, they discussed the problem. And then they told them that they should set out among them the people who interacted with, and they felt pacified, they felt esteemed, they felt cherished. That same example is instructive for all leaders. As we go back to our various locations, by our deeds, by our deliberations, by our discussions, by our disclosures, everything pertaining to us, we show to the congregation that we esteem the flock of Christ over which he has made us overseers. But then we realize something. While the people were given an opportunity, not all the time, at this instance, they were given an opportunity to make their contribution or suggestion or recommendation. Look at it yourself in Acts chapter 6, in verse 3. Wherefore, brethren, look ye out among you 7 men of honest report, full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom. People's recommendation and consultation. But that is subject, number 3, to pastoral rules and confirmation. Pastoral rules and confirmation. Because at the end of that verse, they say, whom we may appoint, the power, the prerogative to appoint, rest squarely on the shoulder of the pastor. You may suggest, you may recommend, but we have to appoint. We scrutinize. If the suggestion is okay, by the standard of Scripture and by the leading of the Spirit of God, we take it. If it is not, as we are led by the Lord, we put it aside and we put in place the righteousness the Lord is leading. How many times people feel slighted? How many times people want to leave the church? Even leaders, they say yes, the overseer wants to have his way. The good coordinator wants to have his way. He doesn't listen to people's suggestions. But don't you know that the power of appointment, the power of approval, the prerogative of final decision rests squarely with the pastor by the revelation of the word of God? When Jethro gave suggestion to Moses, he was more mature and more experienced in ministry. He saw an obvious flaw, administrative flaw, and he corrected it wisely. But then he still said, if he, I'm telling you, the Lord leads you so. Because he understood that The power of final appointment and approval rests with the pastor. Number four, proper realization of core commitment. Proper realization of core commitment. What does that mean? Come back to Acts chapter 6. In verse 3, wherefore, brethren, look ye out among you several men of honest report, full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom, whom we appoint over this business. Why? Because in verse 2, they have said, it is not reasonable, it's not sensible, it's not profitable for us and for the church that we should leave the word of God and the study table. In verse 4, we will give ourselves concentration, commitment, a covenant. We will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the world. How many times today we find pastors who have a false understanding of humility? For example, the church is coming and thousands are waiting for the move of God, for the trust of God, for the blessings from heaven. And few days of retreat, when we feel that the man of God is tarrying, seeking the face of God, you find him cutting bamboo, giving directives. He's doing what others can do while he's living on draw what others cannot do for him. And when we get to the retreat, you don't see much. Because you cannot reveal the God you have not found, and you have not met, and you have not seen. And they begin to say, in those days, how many were we in those days? Many years ago, our generation pretended that intimated us with a lot of things. And we're being reminded, remember, the memorial. All of us, when we come from all over this nation for workers' meeting, we were using Holiness Chapel. A small building there. But now see how many of us are we talking about national workers' meeting. But now see leaders alone. Things have grown. We have to learn to delegate. But delegate, don't abdicate. Because generally, people don't do what you expect, they do what you inspect. So as you initiate things and you involve the people, you also inspect them to ensure that the right thing is being done. Then number five, we see pattern of raising such leaders. Pattern of raising such leaders. It's so clear here how leaders are raised, how ministers are raised, how men and women over the world are raised. It's not a result of tribal sentiment. It's not a fruit of bootlicking and psychopathy. No. Leaders are raised simply by the leading of the Lord. By the leading of the Lord. According to the word of God. But an added insight is also given here. Now go back to Acts chapter 6. In verse 3. Wherefore, brethren, look ye out among you. Several men of honest report. The word report is indicative and suggestive. It means you've known them, tested and trusted. The report is all abroad. Like Timothy in Acts chapter 16, they were telling Paul, there is a brother here. There is a son of the ministry here. There is a dependable laborer here. There is a true follower here. There is a fervent disciple here. There is a committed laborer here. The report, honest report, report of transparency. People regard death. They know their life for who they are. We don't just speak new voices. And we don't know their background. We don't know their life. Nobody has any report about them. And we just throw them there into the work of the ministry. We'll be disappointed. I pray the Lord will help us in Jesus' name. This is the background. At this time of need, even a man. Now come to Acts chapter 6, verse 5. And the saying, please, the whole multitude, and they chose, actually they suggested, they recommended Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Ghost, and Philip, and Prochorus, and Nicanor, and Timon, and Parmenas, and Nicholas, a proselyte of Antioch. Now, where is the power of final appointment? But he is whom they set before the apostles. And when they had prayed, they laid their hands on them, commission there for the work ahead. Now, we come to the biography of Stephen. As we look at the biography of Stephen, seven things come out clearly. Number one, the man called Stephen. Number two, the ministry of Stephen. Number three, the miracles by Stephen. Number four, The malice against Stephen. Number 5. The meekness of Stephen. Number 6. The mercy of Stephen. So the science is. And then, number 7. The martyrdom of Stephen. Number 1. The man called Stephen. In Acts chapter 6 verse 5. The same pleased the whole multitude. And they chose Stephen. A man. What a man. What a man. A man full of faith and of the Holy Ghost. What a description. What wonderful credential. What testimonial. A man full. Not a man devoid of grace. Devoid of wisdom. Devoid of the needed resources to lead the people of God to the promised land. A man full of faith and of the Holy Ghost. We see in the life of this man the profile of the man, the pattern of his making, and his preparation for ministry. The profile of the man, he was a saved man. Born again, he was a sanctified man. The deep work of grace had been done in his heart. He was holy through and through. He was a spirit-filled man. That much is repeated in scripture. He was, number 4, a sought-out man. Sought out, set for, selected. And then number 5, he was a searching for man. The people recognized, respected, regarded, and recommended him. The apostles applauded his choice, approved of him, and appointed him. Searching for man. And then number 6, he became a serving man. He diligently exercised the duties of his office. And we realize in all this, number 7, he was a specially made man. And that shows us the pattern of his making and the pattern of the making of the average servant of God. In the making of his men, what does God do? One, he melts. He is the potter. We are the clay. After melting, what does he do? He molds. And in all that, he makes. After the making, he mandates. He mandates the man to carry out an assignment for him. Then he manifests the man. And then he magnifies the man. The Lord will help us to be yielded verses in his hands in Jesus' name. And that accounts for the preparation of the man for ministry. Now, the ministry of Stephen, he was set apart as one of the deacons to oversee the distribution of food. The miracles by Stephen in Acts chapter 6 verse 8. Stephen, full of faith and power, did great wonders and miracles among the people. He achieved increasing prominence and power. And as a result, because of his fiery messages and effective ministry, he drew the anger, the wrath of the opponents of the true gospel of that time. So number 4, the malice against Stephen. In verse 9, then there arose certain of the synagogue, which is called the synagogue of Libertine and Cyrene, Alexandria, and of them of Cilicia and of Asia, disputing with Stephen. Howbeit, they were not able to receive the wisdom and the spirit by which he spake, but they would not give up. So the suborned men, which said, we have had this speak blasphemous words against Moses, against God. And they steered up the people and the elders and the scribes, and came upon him and caught him and brought him to the council, and set up false witnesses. You see in each verse. Verse 11, the suborned men. Verse 12, they steered up the people. Verse 13, they set up false witnesses. All in malice against Stephen. But through it all, you could see his reservation, his comportment, his humility, his quietness. Number 5, the meekness of Stephen. And then, as he was called upon to make his defense, in chapter 7, you have a long passage where you have the message of Stephen to the Sanhedrin. It was cutting and piercing and penetrating. You see that later in their time. Because of that, they rose up, they stoned him to death, the martyrdom of Stephen. The overall success of Stephen stemmed from his worthy credentials. He was pure and powerful. He was holy and Holy Ghost filled. He was sanctified and spirit filled. Purity is important. We must not fail to pray through, to having it, leading it out, proclaiming it, spreading it, and defending it. But then, purity without power is seemingly impotent. That's why the Lord has led that in this program, you have seen the emphasis on purity. And you have seen also, by the side, the emphasis on empowerment. That as we get purified and purged and polished by God, prepare for greater eyes, we receive the power too. And we go out there to get the work done. The Lord will help us in Jesus' name. In today's message, we shall see three things. One, the character and charisma of Stephen, the minister. The character and charisma of Stephen, the minister. Two, the contemporary challenges from Stephen for all ministers. The contemporary challenges from Stephen for all ministers. And three, the climax and consummation of Stephen's ministry. The climax and consummation of Stephen's ministry. Now we go to the first part, the character and charisma of Stephen, the minister. Again in Acts chapter 6. In verse 5, and the same pleased the multitude, and the church Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Ghost. Verse 8, Stephen full of faith and power, did great wonders and miracles among the people. Verse 10, and they were not able to receive the wisdom and the spirit by which he spake, the charisma. How about the foundation of charisma, the character? Originally, the people were told in verse 3, look here among you several men of honest report, regarded, recognized, reputed to be holy, transparent, men of integrity and innocence, a confirmation of their manifest sanctified lives. So, we see the character and charisma of Stephen the minister. Stephen presents to us a beautiful balance and blend of character and charisma. Faithfulness and fruitfulness, grace and gift, holiness and purity on one hand, and Holy Ghost power on the other hand, integrity and inspiration, purity and power. First, we are going to look at his enviable character, and then we look at his excellent charisma. Now, his enviable character. We see in the first place that Stephen had Christ-like character. In Acts chapter 7, in verse 60, and he kneeled down and cried with a loud voice, Lord, may not this thing to be a charge. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. He died without malice to any man. He died forgiving with a clear conscience, just like the Savior that said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. What a Christ-like man. What a Christ-like life. What a Christ-like character. Number two, charitable character. He forgets freely and easily. Number three, compassionate character. That's in Acts chapter 6, verses 5 to 7. Very hospitable. Number four, conscientious character. Hardworking. Lazy men are not generally holy men. Because when a man has been made holy, his heart will burn in love to God and for fellow men. He will be steward and zealous of all good works. Conscientious character. Hardworking. Committed to duty post. Number five, condescending character. He was humble and lowly. He was gifted but not graceless. He had authority but he coupled it with humility. He was easily noticed. Before he came into position and prominence, before he had the privilege and the platform of ministry, he had been there, effective, efficient, doing good things. Because that's why they could spot him out. This one is full of the Holy Ghost. He carries the anointing. He lives in the realm of the supernatural. But all that did not puff him up or make him haughty, arrogant, self-willed, uncontrollable. And when he came into ministry, he started with the original position he was given. But then it became clear to all that God had something more for him. And as he kept on doing all that, We see the record of the supernatural manifestations, the supernatural occurrences. He was not puffed up. He was still submissive, obedient, and tender, yielded, loving, following leadership. What do you see there? Humility by excellence, a condescending character. Number three, he had a controlled character. Controlled character. He was harmless and temperate. What does that mean? He did not have any desire for revenge. He did not wish his enemies evil. He did not pray for destruction upon those who killed him. He left the world a dying, but a praying that the Lord will pardon and save his killer. He controlled his reaction in peril, under pressure, and when faced with serious persecution and in provocation. Provocation has been the undoing of many people who lay claim to the experience of sanctification. They run from temptation. They avoid seduction, but they fall under the armor of provocation. That's why the Lord has brought us here, so that he can perfect his work in our lives. And I believe that the Lord who has started the work will perfect it in our lives at this place in Jesus' name. Number seven, he had clear character. What is clear character? Transparent character. Innocent character. Honest character. He was said to be of honest report. That was one of the prime requirements for his choice and calling. Number eight, he had confident character. Because we are told in Acts chapter 3 verse 8, he was a man of unwavering faith. A man of confidence in God. And then lastly, he had consistent character. Hard won and lifelong. He never wavered in his faith. He never settled for anything scandalous. He lived a consistently shining, saintly, and salty life to the very end. May the Lord help us to have the testimony of consistency in Jesus' name. Now we look at his excellent charisma in Acts chapter 6 again. Acts chapter 6, I read from verse 5. Acts chapter 6, verse 5. And the same pleased the whole multitude, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Ghost, and Philip, and Prochorus, and Nicanor, and Timon, and Parmenas, and Nicholas, a proselyte of Antioch. In verse 8, and Stephen, full of faith and power, did great wonders and miracles among the people. In verse 10, and they were not able to receive the wisdom and the spirit by which he spake. But told in verse 3, look ye out among you seven men of honest report, full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom, who may appoint over this business. Obviously, he qualified on this ground. So we see that Philip was a man of excellent character and excellent charisma. As we analyze his charisma, what do we see? Number one, we see confounding miracles. Miracles that could not be refuted. Thank God, in our ministry today, through the ministry of our general superintendent, we are seeing miracles that cannot be doubted or debated. Miracles that are clear, manifest. Doctors are attesting to it. People left church and center are attesting to them. Such miracles characterize the ministry of Stephen, confounding miracles. Miracles that disarm his opponents, that they could not argue against. They have to look for other charges, fabricated charges, to book him. Number two, he had a compelling ministry. Compelling ministry. In Acts chapter 6, they were said, they were not able to receive the wisdom and the spirit by which he spoke. That's a compelling ministry. Number three, he had convicting messages. Convicting messages. In Acts chapter 7, in verse 64, when they had these things, after he had finished his sermon, they were caught to the earth, and they gnashed on him with their teeth. Number four, he had charismatic manifestations, manifold spiritual gifts. In Acts chapter 7, verse 55, but he, being full of the Holy Ghost, he looked up steadfastly into heaven, and he saw the glory of God, and Jesus standing on the right hand of God. Not only that, in verse 54, We are told when they had these things, they were caught to the ark, and they lashed on him with their feet. All along, they had listened attentively. What is that? We have number five, captivating ministration. In difference to the call of someone of the gospel was not possible under the ministry of Stephen. It's either you repented or you revolted. But to be indifferent was not possible. That shows the mighty hand of God upon his life. Such leaders listen. If a man could secure the attention of an hostile audience that were interested only in his destruction and death for a lengthy message, how come? We are not able to secure the attention of a weary audience that left all their houses to gather in our front and they get bored. The difference is what we are talking about today. Spirit, sanctified, and spirit filled. Number six, we have a complete ministry. Complete ministry. As we read in Acts chapter 6, verses 5 and 8, the elements of the miraculous and the supernatural confirm his messages. And then number 7, he had a comprehensive all-round ministry. He was an effective evangelist. He was a resounding revivalist. He was a tremendous teacher of the word. He was an active administrator. A comprehensive ministry. These are the manifest aspects of his character, meaning charisma. Now we come to point number 2. What challenges do we have from Stephen for all ministers today? The contemporary challenges from Stephen for all ministers. Stephen has become a model for contemporary ministers who long for lifelong usefulness, who create a surpassing blend of character and charisma, who pant after purity and power today. What do we learn from his record? What are the challenges today from his record? Number 1, spiritual experiences. Spiritual experiences. Stephen was soundly saved, scripturally sanctified, and saturatedly spirit-filled. These are basic, minimum, foundational, and fundamental requirements of spiritual leadership today. If you read through the Acts of the Apostles, you discover that the minimum requirement for service, for ministry, for leadership was the baptism in the Holy Ghost. If you are here and you are not yet baptized in the Holy Ghost, you've had several opportunities. And we still have opportunity this evening to seek the face of the Lord and to receive the power. Number 2, signs and exploits. Signs and exploits. We read that in Acts chapter 6, verses 3, 5, 8, and 10. Stephen, full of faith and power, did great wonders and miracles among the people. The true God-sent minister of Christ has his ministry and messages confirmed with signs following. This is imperative for great gospel breakthrough. If you don't have it, if you don't see signs following and confirming your ministry, desire it. Don't despise it. Many of us are specialists in condemning what you don't have. Always talking against what you have not paid the price to acquire. But do you know that there are manifest reasons in scripture why every minister should pray through to have the supernatural dimension to his ministry? Number 1, it is a mark of the approval of God upon your ministry in Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2. In verse 22. Ye men of Israel, hear this word. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you by miracles and wonders and signs, which God did by him in the midst of you all, as you yourselves also know. A man approved of God among you by miracles and wonders and signs. Not only that, signs and exploits are needed for the confirmation of the word. In Mark chapter 16, Mark chapter 16, in verse 20, and they went forth and preached everywhere, the Lord walking with them and confirming and confirming the world with signs following it. Apart from that, signs and wonders are needed for divine witness. In Hebrews chapter 2, I read from verse 3, how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord, and was confirmed to us by them that heard him, God also bearing them witness, both with signs and wonders, and with diverse miracles, and gifts of the Holy Ghost, according to his own will. You know, there's too many leaders this today. If you say, pray for the sick, they say, oh, don't you know? I am not the general superintendent. But the scripture teaches us like father, like son. And the GS has expressly taught and told us the secret of having a supernatural ministry, that the longing of his heart, he has successfully imparted the teaching ministry. And many pastors outside the palace, they say, we teach like Pastor W. Ekumuni. Because they listen to the greatest messages for this missing dimension. From this program will become the manifest dimension in Jesus' name. So, we should not despise what we don't have. We should rather desire it and pay the price for it. So signs and wonders are needed for divine witness. Not only that, for the full gospel in Romans chapter 15. Romans chapter 15, in verse 16, that I should be the minister of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles, ministering the gospel of God, that the offering up of the Gentiles shall be acceptable, being sanctified by the Holy Ghost. In verse 19, through mighty signs and wonders, by the power of the Spirit of God, so that from Jerusalem and round about unto Jericho, I have fully preach the gospel of Christ. What do we mean by full gospel? Jesus saves, Jesus heals, Jesus delivers. If in your ministry, Jesus only saves, but you're so healed, you're not yet preaching the full gospel. But the fullness of the gospel, the supernatural dimension must be there in our ministry. You see, the challenges, spiritual experiences, signs and exploits. Number 3, supplicating exceedingly. Stephen was eminently prayerful. That's in Acts chapter 7, verses 59 and 60. As ever, the rule of the kingdom is asking, for God does nothing except in answers to prayer. Actually, we live sadly, we live blindly, and we labor dryly because we pray meanly. It's our laziness in seeking after God. Stephen was continually pure and constantly powerful because he was consistently prayerful. He prayed in pain. He prayed under pressure. He prayed in peril. He prayed under persecution. He prayed in provocation. He lived communion with Christ. He labored communion with Christ. And he led to glory communion with Christ. What an example that we are challenged to be prayerful. In Jeremiah chapter 33. In verse 3, call unto me, and I will answer thee and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. Ministers of the gospel, this is a great challenge to us. I see three things here. Number 1, the commandment. Come unto me. You need the anointing? Come unto me. You want revival fire to fall in your church? Come unto me. Come in prayer. Tarry in my presence. Pay the price to seek my face. Put away the distractions of the world. Feel and know that I am God. Come. Come. Come into your closet. Seek the face of the Father and see what great blessings will follow. It's a commandment. Come unto me. Before you preach, call unto me. Before you sing, call unto me. Somebody said, we have many organizers, but few agonizers. How the Lord is carrying us up today to learn to pray. So we see here the commandment, come unto me. And added to that commandment, we now see a commitment. What's the commitment? I will answer thee. If you will but pray, I will answer thee. If you will but seek, I will answer thee. If you will but knock, I will answer thee. He gives a commandment. He makes a commitment. And he tells us, as a result of his answer to prayer, there will be number three, a commencement. Commencement of what? Look at this. I will show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not, the unusual, the unprecedented. We have usual ministry, usual services, usual experiences, because as we have been told over and over again, if we do what we've always done, then we have what we've always had. But we make up our mind to allow the fire of God and the spirit of grace and supplication to come upon us, things will be new. We obey God's commandments, then we enjoy His great commitment, and there will be a glorious commencement. The new facet of our life, ministries, families, and churches in Jesus' name. Number four, scriptural exposition. That's another talent from Stephen. Stephen's message to the Pharisees was convincing, convicting, causing, confronting, confounding, captivating, clarifying, and crushing. Do you know what? The sermon was long, covering over 50 verses, but lovely and lively. It was detailed, but not dry and dull. It was full, but fiery and fresh. It was pungent, practical, penetrating, and powerful. Why? I give you the reasons quickly. Number one, the depth of scripture. You look at the message, loaded with scripture. The depth of scripture. Number two, the dimension of structure. The way he structured the message, it was a must listen to. Look at Acts chapter 7. I just give you the instance of Moses. In verse 23, and when he was full 40 years old, he came into his house to visit his brethren, the children of Israel. Verse 30, when 40 years were expired, there appeared to him in the wilderness of Moshina an angel of the Lord in a flame of fire in a bush. Verse 36, he brought them out after that, he showed wonders outside the land of Egypt and in the Red Sea, and in the wilderness 40 years. You see the natural divisions of the life and ministry of Moses. Stephen gave us that insight, tremendous insight. You read through this message, you see the dimension of structure. Number three, the delivery aided by the Spirit. Not just enticing words of human wisdom, but the anointed, inspired sermon. Number four, the desperation of the speaker. He was in earnest. He was fervent. He spoke from a passionate heart. How many preachers today speak as if they are not even convinced of what they are talking about? As if what they are talking about is optional. They talk dryly, without fire and passion. Number five, the enunciation of faith. It was pointed preaching. There was no mistaking its reference and focal point. The enunciation of faith. Number six, the directed, targeted speech. Number seven, the declaration of the Savior. Christ-centered message. He took them through the long history of the Patriarchs, the heritage of Israel, the brief covenant of God, and brought them back to the Savior of all ages. He focused the attention again on the Messiah, the declaration of the Savior. And you could see from this message, number eight, the diligence of study. Study to show thyself approved unto God, and thy prophecy will appear unto all. Our laziness in study and shallowness of understanding, it's often shown at the purity. We appear to be spiritual loafers to realize the eternal reality. But may God pardon us. Not only that, number nine, we see the determined supplication. He prayed. He saw the face of God. Many preachers are likened to be called aimless wanderers today. They preach without purpose, without power, without passion, without persuasion, without pungency. They aim at nothing and they eat it. These are preachers of drab, dry, dull, and dead sermon. So how comes the urgent plea of the Spirit, the letter to me. Number five, supernatural enlightenment. You see that in Acts chapter 6, verses 1 to 10, and Acts chapter 7, verse 65. Stephen's eyes were spiritually and supernaturally open to eternal reality and heavenly personality. Our ministers of today, who grew up in darkness, who live in blindness, who decide with uncertainty and lingering confusion, they need to seek the Lord. Seek His word. Seek His way. And seek His way. Number six, challenge. Sure of status in eternity. Philip was doubly and doggedly sure of his destination at the point of departure from the world. The certainty of our entrance unto glory at every moment of time or life remains a pivotal, primary, and prominent motivation for all our deeds, desires, decisions, dealings, and discussions. Number 7, the spirit and human. The crowning distinction of Stephen's ministry, the crucial distinction of Stephen's messages, the central and definitive appeal of Stephen's ministration is the anointing. That's in Acts chapter 6, verses 3, 5, 8, and 10, and chapter 7, verse 65. The limit of our fruitfulness, our excellence, our usefulness, our effectiveness, our competence, our efficiency, our resourcefulness, and lots more is the level of our anointing. With all your getting, get the anointing. We come now to point number 3, the climax and consummation of Stephen's ministry. Very quickly, I read from Acts chapter 7, verse 54. When they heard these things, they were caught to the earth, and they gnashed on him with their teeth, but he being full of the Holy Ghost, looked up steadfastly to heaven, and saw the glory of God, Jesus standing on the right hand of God, and said, Behold, I see the heavens open, and the Son of Man standing on the right hand of God. And they cried out with a loud voice, and stopped their ears, and ran upon him with one accord, and cast him out of the city, and stoned him. And the witnesses laid down their clothes, and the young man whose name was Saul. And they saw Stephen calling upon God, and said, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. And he kneeled down, and cried with a loud voice, Lord, lay not this thing to their charge. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. The potent ministry of Stephen brought the opposition of the leaders of the synagogue. And because of his remarkable defense before the council of Jews, in which he summarized Old Testament teachings and related them to Christ, he was cited as a blasphemer, apprehended, and cast out of the city to be brutally stoned to death, thus becoming the first martyr of the Christian church. Actually, the word martyr originally meant a witness, one who gives testimony or a spectator of anything. But with the cruel death of Stephen, the term marked the beginning of one who died for his fidelity to Christ and his work. 3 times over, this word is used in Scripture. In Acts chapter 22, in verse 20, Acts chapter 22, in verse 20, And when the blood of thy Messiah, Stephen, was shed, I also was standing by, and consenting unto his death, and kept the raiment of them that slew him. That's Paul calling Stephen Messiah. Revelation chapter 2. Revelation chapter 2, in verse 13. I know thy work, and where thou dwellest, even where Satan sits, and thou holdest fast my name, and hast not denied my faith, even in those days wherein Antipas was my faithful martyr, who was slain among you, where Satan dwelleth. In Revelation chapter 17, in verse 6, And I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I wondered great admiration. But we come back to the climax of Stephen's life. What do we see as he is about to end his earthly sojourn and service? Number 1, the fullness of glory. The fullness of glory. His face shone with glory. In Acts chapter 6, verse 15, all that sat in the council, looking steadfastly on him, saw his face as it had been the face of an angel. It shone with glory. Not only that, he spoke of the God of glory. In Acts chapter 7, in verse 2, And he said, Men, brethren and fathers, Athens, the God of glory, appeared unto our father Abraham when he was in Mesopotamia before he dwelt in Haran. Not only that, he saw the glory of God. In Acts chapter 7, Acts chapter 7, look at it yourself. In verse 55, But he, being full of the Holy Ghost, looked up steadfastly into heaven and saw the glory of God. And Jesus standing on the right hand of God. And after he was killed, he sailed into the glory beyond. He sailed shone with glory. He spoke of the God of glory. He saw the glory of God, and he sailed into that glory eventually. What is challenge? To all of us, that we should live a sanctified life and lead our people to the experience of sanctification, because the fullness of glory is guaranteed. John Wesley, when he was asking the opponent of sanctification, one of the things he said, well, you may have been. You may linger in unbelief. But there is one thing you cannot take away from us. Our people die well. Because before they leave the world, they know where they are going. Not only the fullness of glory, number two, the fulfilled giant. That's in Acts chapter 7, verses 65 and 66. Could not God have spared Stephen, like John the Beloved? Could not God have secured his release from these persecutors and murderers? The truth is, he has finished his course. He has fought a good fight. He has fulfilled his ministry and mission. So, home, headquarters, heaven, beckon. Number three, the people gallant. That's in Acts chapter 7, verses 55 and 56. The double mention of seeing Christ Jesus standing on the right hand of God. Such a posture has a double significance. One, Stephen had been courageously standing up for the defense of Jesus before those who rejected him. Now, Jesus is standing up in approbation, in approval, in applause of his servant's noble and faithful witness, and also his token that he will sustain through the severe trial shortly before his promotion to glory. And so, what do you see? He stood for Christ, and Christ literally stood for him. Oh, honor him, and he will honor you. Not in vain, never in vain, is your love, your loyalty, your labor for him. By these ministers of the gospel, missionaries in faraway lands, mighty instrument of God, our beloved and cherished Father in the Lord, by these be encouraged, your love, your labor, your loyalty to the Lord is being recognized and will be rewarded. Stand for him, and he will stand for you. Honor him, and he will honor you. Second, the further application of the standing post of Jesus is that from sitting, you read through the scripture, you see him seated at the right hand of God. Matthew 26:64, Acts chapter 2, verse 34, Colossians chapter 3, verse 1, Ephesians chapter 1, verse 20, Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3, and on like that. That from sitting at the right hand of God, he had risen and was ready to welcome his follower who had been faithful unto death as he entered the door of heaven. What a wonderful reception that must have been. We read of Lazarus, angels took him to Abraham's bosom. But here we read of a soldier of the cross. The Lord of glory waited for him to personally welcome him. Stand for him. Shine for him. Live for him. Labor for him. Honor him, and he will honor you. Number four, the fruit of his grief. In Acts chapter 8, verse 1, write it down. And Acts chapter 7, verse 58. And Acts chapter 22, verse 20. In all these passages, we see that Saul of Tarsus was there. He even witnessed to it, where he called Stephen a martyr. Saul of Tarsus, a young man of 28 years of age, witnessed Stephen's demise, or decease, or death, or departure. The imprint, the impact, the import, the impression of Stephen's death and prayer led his conversion and growth to become the most notable stalwart of the faith in the early church. What a striking confirmation. This transformation was of the story of Tertullian, that the blood of Matthias is the seed of the sin. All the grief that you are enduring today is not in vain. The Lord Jesus Christ, when he saw the fruit of his travail, he was up. Number five, the fascinating graces. The fascinating graces. Acts chapter 7, verses 59 and 60. The serious post of prayer and pardon for his enemies or killers, we see the climax of his practically holy life, manifested in humility, charity, opportunity, and superfluity of kindness. Number six, the faithfulness to God to the end. As in Acts chapter 7, verses 55 to 60. Stephen was never found wanting in his living for, learning from, living on, loving, loyalty, and laboring for the Lord. He never wavered. He stood resolute. He sat and suffered to the very end. His life example and the Lord's exhortation to us is, do thou respond to death, and I will give thee a crown of life. And then the forgiveness of the godly. Stephen's twofold prayer at the twilight of his life are exactly in the mold and according to the model of the Lord's prayers on the cross. As the Lord prayed, into thy hands I commend my spirit, he prayed, Lord Jesus, to keep my spirit. As the Lord prayed, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what to do, he prayed, Lord, lay not this thing to their heart. The forgiveness of the godly. Fittingly, Stephen died in the Lord. Stephen died for the Lord. Stephen died like the Lord. Because of what I've explained, that he died praying like his Lord. He will die to the Lord. He will die unto the Lord. He will die for being with the Lord. He will die beloved, beheld, and beaten by the Lord. Because as he was dying, the Lord was weeping. People were crying, those who loved him. Others were laughing, those who killed him. The Lord was smiling, waiting for his servant, because it was the day of translation, the day of promotion. He died, number one, pleading for sinners' pardon, Acts 7:60. He died, number two, praying and supplicating passionately, Acts 7, verses 59 and 60. He died, number three, persuaded, steadfast, and persevering, Acts 7, verses 65 and verses 66 to 60. He died, number four, passionate for souls, lest they perish, Acts 7, verse 60. He died, number five, pure, spotless, and preserved, Acts 7, verse 69. He died, number six, power-packed, spirit-filled, and potent, Acts 7, verses 65 to 66 and 69. He died, lastly, persuaded and sure of paradise, Acts 7, verses 65 to 66 and 69. He bled and died. This is last. Body broken, battered, and bloody, his spirit gone to the Maker. He died for the one who had died for him, but he was talking, beside, determined, devoted, dedicated, to the very last, to the very end. What is a land? He that sweareth his own oath and changeth not. And then came the crowning glory, the conquered color. Spirit, sanctified, and spirit filled. Rise up and let us pray. When I've gone the last mile of the way, I will rest at the place of the grave. And I know there are joys that await me. When I've gone the last mile of the way. minister. I will offer an acceptable service and sacrifice of today. First, he produces, and then he empowers. He empties the vessel of cell, and he fills the vessel with his spirit. You too, like Stephen, can be sanctified as spirit-filled. An awful weapon in the hands of the Most High. The promise is unto you. He offers the name. Receive the anointing and the power of the Holy Ghost. Any man says, let him come unto me and drink, and out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. Rivers of living water. Are you thirsty? Are you hungry? Are you desirous? Are you panting? Are you longing? The heavens are open. The heavens are open. The heavens are open. Thou Christ of burning, cleansing flame, send the fire, send the fire, send the fire. Look down and see this working host. We want another Pentecost. Send the fire, send the fire, send the fire. The Lord ministers, millions of lost souls are looking to be won. They have come from regions and states and local governments and towns and communities and countries. Church members are waiting. Lost souls are waiting. Who is sufficient for all these things? Our sufficiency is of God, who has made available the power to do the work. Come before him as a ready vessel. Seek his face and let him fill you to overflow you. And out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. Seek the face of the Lord. As we go from here, this early stage of holiness shall be preserved, proclaimed, and practiced. Holiness unto the Lord is our watchword and song. Holiness unto the Lord as we are marching along. Sing it. Shout it loud and long. Holiness unto the Lord now and forever. Are you wavering your conviction? Are you being overwhelmed with a flood of persecution? opposition. Career. Stand. Stand for him. Stand for him. And he will stand for you. In Jesus' name we pray. Everlasting Father, we thank you for the challenging life of Jesus, a product of the matchless grace of God and its willing and eager heart to seek you. We can come as vessels unto you. And Father, we pray, you will purge, you will prove, you will polish. Empty us of self. And Father, Father, look at the field of harvest. Millions of perishing souls, indigenous people, interior places, the inhibited populace face up to the iron walls of religious intolerance. But we know that with the power of your spirit, Jericho walls will collapse. Jordan will give way. When we enter in and possess the land in the name of Jesus. Oh, Father, behold your army. Empower your army. Father, empower your army. Oh, Lord, empower your army. Fill us with the Holy Ghost. Not emotion, but energy, power, fire, anointing, boldness, wisdom. And we go from here to conquer, to penetrate, and to win. Lord, you have challenged our heart to stand for you. No matter the peril, the provocation, the pressure, the persecution, the pain, the predicament, the problem, the plight of man. Lord, help us to stand for you to the very end. We want to thank you because you have answered us. Help us, Lord, that we will be men of the future. Because men are women of prayer. Help us, Lord, to prevail where it matters. Prevail yourself, my mortal. And Lord, we ask once again, leave nothing undone in our lives before we leave you. We thank you. In Jesus' name, we pray.